QA tester at BoxUK, and my job basically involves working with developers and all sorts of smart, intelligent IT people along the way, designers, analysts, in order to ensure that the quality of our product is as high as possible. And some of you may be a bit confused by the slightly provocative title of my talk, but I assure you that it is all going to make sense by the end of it, hopefully, maybe. So I'm here to talk to you today basically about why you should build a collaborative and integrated relationship between your software developers and between your QA testers in order to ensure that the success of your project is guaranteed. You're going to have a high quality product and you're going to have happier people. And I'm really lucky that in my job at the moment, I get to work with people who are like-minded. We have that in place. So today it's sort of aimed at people who have this kind of attitude, who want maybe some practical guidance to how we can make it a bit better. People who aren't sure if that's the way they want to work. Maybe they like developers and testers being separate and it works for them. And maybe they're thinking about a new approach and if it can be done better. And those who love Agile and just love talking about it. And those who aren't Agile yet and are just like, well, what is this all about? So, to begin my story, I'm going to look at the great divide between testers and developers, which we have in our traditional testing approach and development approach. We are separate sides, and I didn't realise how on topic this was going to be when I made the slides. So we have our testing right at the end of the development project. We have what we want to make. We design it, we build it, we test it, and we send it over to our client. Well, you know, what could be argued is right with that? I mean, it's quite a simple model, it's easy to flow, everyone knows what they're doing. So we're going to build this amazing, sexy product and then give it to our client, it's all going to work perfectly, right? Well, no. No, it's not. Unless everybody on your team is absolutely sure of the requirements, of the acceptance criteria, then by developing in this way and then just handing it over to your testers, you're going to have problems because there's going to be bugs. We've developed right from the bottom up, so anything that you could have found in week one, suddenly 6 months later on, is going to be a much bigger problem, sort of like a big ball of wool that you keep unraveling. And the testing stage is going to be late, you know, in software, especially when we're thinking in an agile way, then, you know, we're going to expect problems. Things are going to go wrong, and we adapt to them. And there's going to be run-on, and if you have that sequential approach, then our testing is going to be squashed, we're going to have less time to find the problems, and we're going to be having a lesser quality product. And the changes are going to be more expensive. I already said that something that was really little to fix in the first place, if we haven't found it, it's going to be harder to fix, and it's going to take more time and more money. So we also have, in this scenario, a bigger problem, which is how we've kind of got developers and testers on different sides of the field. We're separate battle lines as this lovely sheep and cow are demonstrating visually. We're not on the same side. We have this kind of notion in software of work being thrown over the fence between testers and QA. And this does happen in all this does happen in all areas of project development, so between designers and all the other teams. But we especially see it as a problem between QA testers and developers. And it's sort of like this bomb that we both really want to get rid of. We develop it and we think, oh, there we go, just throw it back to QA and hope it works. But as this man, AB, demonstrates, if you're not looking at where you're throwing it, if you're not communicating to who you're throwing it to, then it's very likely it's going to miss. I'm not saying it's always going to miss. You might get lucky, but it is pretty likely that you're not going to have a successful project. So what are we going to do? We decided that this approach isn't going to work. Well, we're going to make it agile. And I am going to bring the agile principles up because when I was planning my talk, there are things that I picked out which really guided me in what I'm going to say. Because we want to build this collaborative approach between testers and developers. We don't want those battle lines. I say battle lines because it really informs how a combative approach that is. We're all on the same team, yet why are we working together? So why is it best? Well, I'm going to pick out a couple words from here and first talk about how I apply Agile to my testing strategy before we talk about how we are going to actively apply this collaborative relationship into our teams. So, Agile Manifesto. First word I see is plan, and that means test plan to a tester. I love having an absolutely thorough, perfectly managed plan that I can execute to ensure that every part of the software is going to be working, it's going to be fabulous, and they're going to find all the problems. Well, no, because plans change. Plans do change. That's something that we have in Agile. We have to accept that things are going to go wrong, and we have to plan for the worst. And so how do we apply that to our test plans? I'm not saying get rid of them. They are incredibly important, but it's about adapting them so that they're more flexible, they're more lightweight. And it's about working with developers to ensure that what are they covering in their automated testing that I don't need to spend time on with my manual testing. And I can perhaps favour a more exploratory approach in this. It's minimum planning and maximum execution. It does require discipline, exploratory testing. It isn't just about going in willy-nilly and blind. It is about taking that acceptance criteria, taking what I want to find in the product and exploring it. And that nurtures a more collaborative relationship with developers. I want to talk to them about what we're trying to do. I want to talk to them about what they've built. Because great quality software isn't about having the most comprehensive test plan. It's about getting it coded, getting it tested, and feeding back what we think about it and what we all are working towards together. So there's three other things, those words in the manifesto, which I can pick up because they're really driving what I'm saying. Those are individuals, so our team members, their interactions, how they're communicating. And then this one at the end, because I think only when you have your individuals collaborating through your actions are you going to have a really successful project and a high quality one. We're breaking down those battle lines that we're so used to having and thinking in a different way. So, you know, you could say, so what? Well, it's worked for us before. We've created software for years and years where we've had our development and then we've had our testing. And, you know, it's worked out pretty well for us. But it can be so much better if you have a QA member, a QA tester there along the whole way of the project cycle. We want to integrate them throughout the entire life cycle of the project. They're not just coming in there at the end. They're all the way from the beginning. And it's also not just necessarily about through the whole cycle. They're actually integrated physically in with your team. We're no longer sitting in different parts of the building on different sides of the room. We're all together. Because I can personally say from experience that just by sitting next to developers, I learn so much more. Because something that they deem isn't that important, a conversation, it can really inform my testing and it can maybe bring up something that, oh, I'm worried about that, can you explain that more to me? And it just allows that osmosis of shared knowledge to happen. So, I decided that the collaborative agile approach is better. We want to integrate our developers and our testers, but just deciding that we want to sit together and deciding we want to collaborate isn't enough. And I spoke to my line manager when I was planning my talk as to why this approach is best, and I was like, oh, how do I even begin? And saying, how, if we've decided we want to do this, how do we? And she said something pure and simple. She just said, you need to have a conversation about how you're going to collaborate. So to collaborate, you need to collaborate on how you're going to collaborate. We need to ask ourselves in our team, all of us together, including QA, our analysts, our designers, our developers, at what points will we all come together? At what points in our project are we going to make sure we are coming together to collaborate? What meetings are going to act as those collaborative standpoints? And how are we going to maintain this collaboration? So we're going to have these specific points set up to ensure that that's happening, but how are we going to make sure we keep it going? How are we going to make sure we keep looking at what's working and if it's not working, addressing that? And also, when we decide what we want from these questions, we need to have this collaborative mindset, this glue that holds it all together. And that's going to take building those questions, answering those things, in order to build this mindset that we all have to make it work. So let's go back to those questions I just asked. I'm going to go through some tried and tested methods that we found worked into building this collaborative relationship, especially when perhaps you have developers or testers who aren't used to working with each other. So, at what points will we all come together going forward? So, daily stand-ups, that's pretty given. You know, you have a 5, 10, 15, if you're not very disciplined, conversation at the beginning of the day with all your team. What did you yesterday? What are you going to do today? And have you got any blockers? But do you have QA there? Are QA deemed important enough to be there? Because they should be there. This is such an important collaborative meeting where we all find out what problems are in our way. Has anyone got any concerns? QA are going to know what work is going to be coming over to them. We're going to ask questions. We're going to iron out any problems. And by asking it in this pocket meeting, we're going to ensure that we're not going to have to be taking you away from your development work when we know you're really into working on something. Any blockers in your way? Sometimes, if I have a problem, it can so easily be sorted by a brief answering to a question by a very intelligent developer. And then I can just get on my merry way and make sure that I can go back to catching problems in my software. So involving QA in these meetings ensures that we're finding more issues before they've even happened. I haven't even gotten to testing, but I'm already thinking about things I need to be looking for, and developers know what I'm going to be looking for as well. So then ticket kickoffs. So I think it's pretty standard in software that we work in a sort of ticketed system, normally with online management such as Jira. But before we even start working on a ticket, we have this little set of ticket kickoff questions where we just gather, it can be the whole team. That's ideal, but normally time constraints mean that maybe a project manager's pulled away, maybe an analyst pulled away. And we have the developers and the QA come together to answer these questions. What is the change? That seems really silly, like to ask, like what is going on? But actually, what if the acceptance criteria hasn't been fully filled in? Part of our definition of done is that the ticket is going to be fully complete with everything involved. But you can't always guarantee that because it's agile and things might have gone wrong and we have to adapt to that. So we're addressing you if this work is ready to start on, because if it isn't, then we shouldn't be starting on it because it's going to cause more problems. Will automated and or manual test scripts be completed as a part of the work? I already spoke about how it's really important, in my opinion, for testers and developers to collaborate on this, because there's no point in us tripping over each other's shoes and doing the same test twice. A friend of mine at work said that he worked somewhere before where the tester was taking over the tickets at the end of the sprint, and he was going through his manual test cases and he was like, I'm not finding any problems. And my friend looked through them and he said, well, to be honest, that's because 95% of this is already covered in automation. And if we'd sort of had this conversation about how we're going to test, how we're going to cover all areas, then would have saved us a lot of time. Assumptions. Oh, that word. That is such a problem sometimes. We assume that somebody knew that there was changing acceptance criteria. We assume that our tester is capable of testing what we're about to develop. Not always the case. We assume that we have all the information we need. If we just ask, are there any assumptions, it can bring out ones that we've missed, and then we can solve them. This happened recently. I found that in a project where we've been using ticket kickoffs, it's been really, really useful and successful. We found things at this stage before it's even gone to development, which means that the ticket hasn't had to fail and it's passed first time. But what happened in the last sprint is, you know, things get a bit stressed and things can slip through the net, and maybe we haven't done so many. And I had a ticket come through, an assumption had been made, and we would have caught it at this point if we just had the ticket kickoff. So just having, it's a really short meeting. It's not even a meeting. It's just 5 minutes, just swiveling our chairs together, looking at the ticket, asking these questions, raising problems. And in this collaborative approach, we're all learning more and making sure we've got the best knowledge possible to develop this work and to test this work. And then story time. So this is another point in which we're going to come together to collaborate. This is a focus session to go over the stories in upcoming work and refine them, looking at the requirements and making sure that we've got everything covered. And it's there to sort of build transparency and clarity across your entire team. And my line manager pointed me towards this really amazing article by Ryan Thomas Hewitt on the Scrum Alliance website called Introducing the Three Amigos. And he talks about these collaborative methods like story time, where we come together, we look at requirements and we find them. And he pointed out a problem, because we're all coming together, but how are we going to successfully collaborate when we all speak in different languages? We've got business analysts who talk in terms of requirements and acceptance criteria. We've got developers in terms of code and unit tests, and we've got QA, what we speak in terms of scenarios and test cases. Well, the value in having these meetings is that we learn to speak in a shared vocabulary. We know how each other's talking, and therefore we can collaborate better if we're all talking from the same page. And you might say, oh, you know, do QA really need to be there? Wouldn't it save us a bit more money, a bit more time, if we just kept it to the real members of the team, just have developers and business analysts? Well, no, QA should be there. We can bring a different perspective because we speak in different languages, but that's a good thing sometimes because we bring different skills. So when I'm exploratory testing, I'm really thinking from a user perspective, like, what if I didn't know how to use this? I'm going to find more problems. And therefore, when we're refining requirements, then I can offer some insight which might have been missed before if we're thinking from it from just the technical point of view. So by having us there, we're fueling more discussion and we're fueling more shared understanding between all of us. So those are some sort of practical methods to how we're going to aid collaboration, how we're going to get developers and testers collaborating together who maybe haven't done so before. But then there's the second question. How are we going to maintain it? It's all very well and good me saying, oh, well, you just come together, you do these meetings, and everything's fine. No, it does take a bit of discipline. People can't just collaborate just off of these meetings. We need to keep reviewing them and making sure that it's right. And transparency is so key here. Any agile advocate will tell you that it's absolutely vital in your team to making sure everyone's on the same page, that they have full transparency of a situation. And how do we make sure that we're maintaining that? It's no one good saying, oh, we need to make sure that everything's clear, because somebody's going to have a document hidden in a file that no one's aware of, and things are going to happen because we have miscommunications. But we've got some methods in place which make sure that we keep on collaborating, we keep on talking, and we keep on working together. So pretty common practice, you know, have a board where we have all our tickets to work, but we actually have a physical board. We have all our tickets there, in progress, to do what's been completed. And might sound like a bit too much overhead, like, oh, I thought that, got it in one place, why do I need a physical board? It's just annoying. But actually, it was really useful, just because just by having that kind of collaborative point for us all to come around, we are naturally going to start working closer together. And also, it highlights problems much quicker, in my opinion, than having a flat screen does. You're going to start thinking more, well, why hasn't that moved from ready and QA? Like, are QA having a problem? Do they need some assistance in getting that through? Another thing that we do to sort of maintain this collaborative mindset, so we have a standard checklist. So in our standards, we've always said that you should have QA there to ensure that you're having a high quality product as possible. But we ask these questions because if you don't ask them, you're not going to get answers. It can be quite easy, I find, for stand-ups just to get into sort of a sedate process. Like you go, oh, what did I do yesterday? What did I do? What did I do today? Have I got any blockers? And people aren't actually raising the problems they have. By having these questions, we're just getting some good processes in place to make sure any problems we have are being addressed as soon as possible, and then not waiting until the end. And it's great for QA to be owners of this, because we want to be empowered in the team. We want to feel like we have worth there. Owning decisions. I think empowering your team in the decisions they're making, not just developers, not just analysts, but also QA, is absolutely vital in fueling this collaborative mindset. Because if everyone's a part owner in decision, they're going to be more motivated to making the product vision and the final thing as amazing as it can be. So by owning our decisions, by having that sort of responsibility, we're going to raise things quicker. We're all on the same page now. And it's going to make the decisions that we make ones that we've made together. So if something goes wrong, then we want to do something about it. And it's not just going to be the developers who sort of cluster around a computer finding out why something's gone wrong. It means the testers involved there, because then when we're doing a release in the future, the problem that was found, they're going to look for it again to make sure it doesn't come back. And getting the most out of your retrospective. That's meant to say retrospective. Somebody said to me that retro is a bit of a half term, so apologies for that. So we're really good in retrospectives at looking at what went wrong, like what changes do we need to make, and that's absolutely vital in reviewing like your collaborative processes that I've just said. Like if somebody thinks that ticket kickoff is taking too long, then let's look at it, let's think why, and let's change it. Let's just not get stuck in the rut. But QA can be really utilised here because we sort of act like thermometers, like emotional thermometers. Did anyone go to the talk earlier on the psychological aspects of estimation? Well, he spoke about how, you know, it's really important to have diversity in your team to pick up on the emotions of others, and that's what we can do. We've seen how much work goes into something. I'm always awed at the complexities of code. I think it's amazing. And sometimes I walk into work and I think I'm in the Matrix because of what's on everyone's screens. But we can really appreciate that. And when something comes over, that's, we know how long it's taken. It might have taken 5 days. It might seem like something small. Has anyone been in a demonstration with a client where something that has taken 5 or 10 days is really small, and they see it and they go, yeah, it's great. Yeah, great. But then they see something really simple and they're like, oh my God, that's amazing. And you're just like, oh, I'm just not getting that. Whereas if QA are in those retrospectives, if we've seen the work that's gone in, then we can make sure that it's championed. So, take a drink of water before I go on. So, we talked about these sessions that are in place to make sure that we're fueling this collaborative relationship with QA and developers. You know, we all want to be in this long-term relationship. And we talked about how we're going to maintain this collaboration, but we need to do a bit more. We need to have these structures in place, but now we need to build on them. And we need to have a collaborative mindset. And this can sound a bit scary. Somebody was talking about earlier, like if you just go charging in with like collaborative culture, it's like, it's not like that, because these things are gonna build this naturally. It's gonna build up. If you've got people doing agile, then they're gonna start thinking agile. They're gonna have a collaborative mindset naturally. And it involves taking away those safe battle lines that we spoke about earlier, and being on the same side. And that's going to be scary. If you've got people who aren't used to working together, there's no good bundling together and just expecting it to work instantly. It is going to take some time, and it's going to take some passion for knowing that agile is the best way forward, for knowing that this collaborative approach is the best way forward. And it's going to take seeing results, because we are going to see results from this approach. We're going to find problems quicker, we're going to resolve them quicker, and then we're going to get them sorted. But there are certain things that we can really champion along through all of this to make sure that we keep it going and we keep it moving. And one of the things is a continuous feedback loop. Like, there was a talk yesterday on it, which was amazing, and I wish that that talk could be inserted now to say that all I want about continuous feedback loop. But it's absolutely essential in reinforcing this collaborative mindset. It's going to feel unnatural for some, because sometimes you just think, oh, it'd be so much simpler if I didn't have to go talk to QA right now. It'd be so much simpler if I just had a go testing and didn't speak to developer. But it's just not the case. We can get things solved quicker just by having that conversation. So we're going to have to review the types of communication we use. We're no longer going to be hiding necessarily behind instant messaging online. Sometimes having that face-to-face communication for a minute is going to solve problems a lot quicker than 100 messages online. And we can take things that we already know about, practices that work, such as pair programming, and then apply them to working with QA. So something we do is we have a sort of pair pro QAing, where we have a programmer and a QA tester sit next to each other when it's something that can the changes can be easily seen. So if there's a lot of front-end changes being made, we can sit alongside them being made, and we can help make decisions. We can help drive the creative process. Because I don't want to fail tickets. I think sometimes that can be seen of like testers, like we get a bit of a kick out of finding a bug. I'm not going to lie, sometimes you find something and you're like, whoa! But we don't like doing that. We want things to work and we want to have as good a product as we can. And this naturally brings us working closer together. This one, I think, is very personally important to me. And Ted, we spoke about it earlier, about having a non-blame culture. Well, this is where I got it from. Less my, more our. I came up with this from a retrospective because I was noticing that I was hearing a lot of, oh, well, it's not my piece of software, I didn't develop it, so it's not my bug. Oh, well, I didn't test that piece of the software, so it's not my problem that it, something got through. Well, no. We're all on the same team here. We've all decided that we want to be part owners. And if we've collaborated on this piece of work, then it's no longer my piece of work or your piece of work, it's our piece of work. It doesn't mean not taking ownership, but it means empowering people through their decision making and through their problem solving. If a release goes wrong, then we all want to be in a position where we want to do something about it. It's not just the developers doing something about it. It's not just the testers testing, but we're all on the same team. And what's important is to just keep doing these things. Like, you're in a long-term relationship with QA now, we're all the way through, you're stuck with us, and we're not going anywhere. And the worst thing to do is to stop collaborating in situations where it gets stressful. That's really natural. Something's going wrong, and you just think, oh, I'll just spend 30 minutes just doing this by myself. I can get it done, I can get it fixed. It'll save so much time, but it won't, because what if you get to the end of that 30 minutes and somebody'd had a conversation that was missed, whereas it would have been caught if we'd just been collaborating. And you're going to see results from this. You're going to have a better product. You're going to have found the risks as quickly as possible. You're going to have found the problems before development has even been completed through these methods. And also you're going to have a happier team, because with this agile mindset, we're changing the way we think with this collaborative mindset. So we're encouraging developers to think more like testers and testers to think more like developers. So that means that developers perhaps no longer obsess so rigidly on the perfect code and just think about making as good a product as possible and thinking about the entire vision. And for QA, it means that we temper our slightly destructive tendencies where we sort of go in and just try and break things and we find as many bugs as we can. But rather, we're more involved in the creative direction of the entire process. And that's really what we want to do. We want to have as high quality as product as possible. And also, you're going to have a happier team. I love working where I work. I love coming into work every day. And it's because developers are the best people I have ever worked with on a whole. And if we're all working together, if we're on the same side of the battle lines, not working against each other, then it's just better for everyone. A QA tester is for life and not just for the end of the project. Because if we found as many problems as we can all the way through, then we're going to ensure a higher quality product and we're going to ensure higher quality standards all the way through. Because with continuous collaboration comes continuous quality, and that's why you should get into bed with QA. There we go. So, thank you. Any questions? Questions? Any things people disagree with?
I've got a loaded question.
Oh, God.
you mentioned that developers do the automated tests, then testers pick up the manual ones. So in a fully automated world, what is the use of testers?
Well, I think that, yeah, you can have a fully automated thing, but that isn't going to capture the edge cases that only exploratory testing can find. What it might do, but you're going to have to spend more time building those automated tests when really you want to go on to do more things, like actually develop. By including us in the process, then we can take some time away from that automated testing while still ensuring we are finding the problems.
I was thinking, because in our organisation, we're going into a fully automated test, and no one's actually doing stuff.
But I think also what
depends on the product, I think.
We feel really strongly about is how QA just isn't about testing. QA is something that's really valuable in the entire process, like in those collaborative meetings. finding the problems before we've even thought of them. We do think differently, we do bring different expertise, so we are going to think things that others don't think of. So I think there is still value there. I talked about us being sort of emotional thermometers. Like, if I know a developer is really stressed, I buy them a custard tart from the Portuguese bakery because they just need it. Although my friend Tom actually said the other day when I brought it back, I don't like custard tarts. And I was like, oh God, I failed. But just having that sort of balance there to make sure that people's efforts are being championed, and also we learn how to approach people better. Because I've worked with people long enough that I know that some people don't want me argy-barging in and asking questions. They'd rather I just wait, I pick up on how they're feeling right now. Whereas others just love me coming over and being like, how does this work? I don't know, can you help me? So I get what you mean by we could have it all automated testing, but where would the fun be?
Are you working on product rather than projects as well? I think in product development, you've got more scope for automated testing.
It's mainly product, yeah.
Yeah, because the work that we do is more on a project by project basis, so we'd never be able to kind of fully automate what Annie said.
I was going to back you up here on your answer, that even whether it's project or product, you cannot escape the benefits that exploratory testing gives you over even having 100% automation. So I've worked on projects where you have had the full automation in, but there's nothing better than just getting that human eye in there and just being a random annoyer who can just break it and just do the things which you've never think you actually can.
If it's just APIs,
yeah,
all of that would be.
Even in APIs, you can still there's still benefits of exploratory
tests. Yeah, but then those exploratory tests couldn't be automated.
You could automate them, but to what value? In the sense that why would you need to keep running that particular test over and over again? And what you're trying to do is explore, and not trying to repeat.
You can use your automated tests to enable your exploratory system. You can if you have your set of test one, you can pump random data in, do all kinds of stuff. You can semi-automate a bunch of stuff, which can be interesting.
You could try.
If someone wants to answer my question.
You could try working with a QA person for a month and see how it goes.
Yeah, bring me in.
You might. You don't know.
Oh yeah, sorry.
Because we've tried to adopt where there isn't a QA person and a developer, it's everybody tries to do everything. So developers will try and not test and equally test processes will try and not code. Obviously, there are experts and specialisms, but in a fully agile, you're trying to blend.
But that doesn't mean that the role of what a QA does is not being fulfilled. It is being fulfilled, yeah. Just being done by potentially people who are developers and not just QAs. But it's more about not the specific role, but having that QA
mindset whoever actually takes on that.
Hiya.
Oh, carry on, I'm pretty much here. You mentioned your story time section, that the different roles, different stakeholders, and we'll have different roles, different language.
Yeah.
Probably another loaded question.
Oh, God.
Have you come across BDD?
I've heard that spoken a lot to me, and I am quite new in this environment, and that's why I feel really happy to be here today, that people want to come and listen to what I've learned so far. But that's something that we have experimented before, but right now,
I think we've got some projects for them.
Yeah.
The whole point of BD is collaborating.
Yeah.
And bringing across the whole concept of what each particular feature is all about, and what we're trying to achieve through the feature, and the common language for expressing that, the intention of how the system should behave. So it kind of solves your whole issue of multiple stakeholders with different backgrounds, different diversity, but also having a common language to communicate and collaborate and continuously collaborate. As a byproduct, it gives us automated testing.
Oh, he said that word again. But I think a problem that you could highlight with that is that if you're bringing together, you know, stakeholders, everyone in the team, then not everyone is immediately going to be speaking that language. So even in the first instance, before we start using that one, we need to appreciate they're all speaking a different one and understand what the other languages we're using. Do you agree, or...?
It's just like anything else. It takes a bit of coaching, a bit of learning.
Takes a bit of time.
And you just
takes that agile mindset.
Yeah, it won't happen overnight, but it's, yeah, it's worth it to have everyone...
Oh, I'm sorry.
just to have everyone, you know, be able to collaborate with the same terms in the same language and understand each other.
I'll go with you and then I'll be back.
Yeah, that's fine,
Carol.
I'm just interested in how you track the test work. Is it done the same manner as the dev work? Does it go on the same scrum board? Or
do
you manage your, is it separate? Does it not get tracked?
As in, what do you mean by that?
So you're writing tests, ticket starts, then you're going to write tests for that, and surely you're going to estimate some time running the tests. So, when you're happy to sign off the ticket is done, does that hold up the sprint goal, essentially? Is that if the development's done, the test is not complete, then the sprint's not complete? And how would you track that on a burn down?
Oh, I see. So we release through as many times as possible. So work is coming through and then we sign it off. So we do have a gradual burn down. And we just adapt to the situation of what is coming through in terms of writing our tests and executing them. We are very flexible in our approach, which is great in Agile, like adapting to change and knowing the best approach to take. It might not be the one that we've used all the other time on the project, but it's about getting what's tested done as soon as possible and getting the feedback done. Have I answered your question? I'm not sure if I have.
Well, I just wanted to know, and that's making presumptions on what you're working on, to be 2 week sprints or, you know, whether it's more fluid. But and then should we hold it into our process where we do all the test tasks alongside the dev tasks and everything counts to the burn down at the end. It's quite a new approach for us.
Yeah, we run off one ticket.
So one Jira ticket would include any kind of investigative work, development and testing. So when you estimate, then you need to consider
as subtasks of that. So, but yeah, it's, we'll get the only burn down or whatever, however it's left on.
So it's like
is left
separate.
On waiting.
So,
you know, so you've got the ticket, the story, and then subtasks of that might be development tasks.
Oh, right,
so subtasks might be test writing, test execution. Obviously, we write automated tests, QAs write automated tests, QAs do manual testing, and so it's how long it takes to do that, and how long you've got left before it's signed off, basically.
In the project that I just worked on, because I test by a ticket by ticket basis, but I did record my manual test scripts in a separate ticket, but I didn't assign any story points to them because in terms of time we estimate by on the first instance how long it's going to take to develop, and I am there in estimation sessions because then if I've got any concerns about how long it's going to take to test, we do have percentage rates really of how long something should be taking to test, but I'm there to say this is going to take a lot longer to test, say if we're doing it across 8 different browsers and devices. So work by ticket basis, but I do put separate tasks in, but they're not necessarily estimated. But a part of this collaborative approach is that I can raise person to person in all of these meetings if I've got concerns, rather than relying on how much time I've estimated towards it. Does that answer?
Yeah, well, I think it's just everyone's different. We're just trying to pick some. We've got to see whatever the people's processes are.
Okay.
Trying to see what else people are doing.
Yeah, so I get the impression that quality assurance is still quite separate in your organisation from your development kind of agile schedule, and you're more as an advisory role than you're doing exploratory testing. You're also very separate from test automation from what we get there. Do you think that's beneficial to be such a separate element within your scrum teams or development teams?
Well, I'm a bit worried about how I've come across, because we are fully integrated into our teams. We're not there as an advisory role because everybody in our team is equal. Everybody has the opportunity to speak up, to say their opinion. And so I'm not there as an advisory role. I'm there as a collaborative role to bring my expertise as everybody in the team is. I spend most of my time testing, but a part of bringing as much value to testing as possible is making sure that I'm involved in all of the same meetings as the developers.
So on test automation, for instance, are you in there with equal measures? In the environments I work in, test automation is generally owned by test or quality assurance, whatever label you want to put on them. Do you think that's something that test and quality assurance should own, the automation element, or is that development centric?
Yeah,
to be
heavy within our
organisation,
we don't have a lot of automation.
Well,
and then manual testing, we don't actually have a lot of automation just because each of our projects is quite bespoke, so the investment in automation would be quite high, quite low return. So, but we do have unit tests, which the developers own, and we have, you know, we get statistics out on test coverage, but most of our testing effort is actually manual.
So how do you cope then with your technical debt in regards to regression testing over your bespoke products? So if you want to go back over your backlog, if somebody makes a change in a core of whatever your product is, and that could have quite a large span, you could spend a sprint doing regression testing manually because you've got no automation repository, no repository of tests there to.
We generally don't have a core product, so we work with, so we develop websites. Our core product, I guess, is we use SiteCore for a lot of our major sites, and then for some smaller sites, we use, say, Bolt or Embraco, so we're kind of technology agnostic. As such, we don't have a core product that we need to consider in terms of regression testing.
Okay.
Does that make sense?
Yeah, kind of. Cool. All right, thank you.
Thank you, Ali, for bringing your expertise to answer that scary question.
Sorry.
I was just like,
so, rightly or wrongly, a lot of people want like metrics, particularly around testing.
Mm-hmm.
In your opinion, what's one metric which really is kind of works, which will create behaviour which conflicts with the collaborative approach that you're promoting? And is there a metric that you think would help?
I spoke about this with Luca yesterday in his talk about the feedback loop, because I asked him, do you find that having these really granular metrics has a negative impact on people? Because they look at front-end metrics and back-end metrics and how many things are failing on the front-end and how many things are failing on the back-end. Personally, I feel that is a bit pointy-fingery, like, oh, it's a front-end problem, it's a back-end problem. So that kind of thing, I think, could possibly interfere. And he did say, well, sometimes, you know, maybe we don't always have them as visible, but then that's another problem because, like, everything should be transparent. But one thing, one metric we tracked, which I did find really useful, is we looked at why something was failing. And we found that this was about a year ago, we found the main reason why something was failing is because an acceptance criteria wasn't being met. It wasn't because it didn't work, it worked brilliantly, but something was missing. And so that's why we put things like the stand-up checklist and the ticket kickoff in to make sure that we were addressing that, making sure the acceptance criteria was going to be addressed. Because like what I said, recently found that we missed the ticket kickoff and then I had to fail something because an acceptance criteria hadn't been met. Does that answer it?
Yeah.
Does anyone else have any other questions? Oh, we're 5 minutes over. Well, thank you very much for coming.